is overwhelming. But not unexpected, I guess, on my behalf. We all love Dave. And we're here today to show our love and our concern to his family. But also we are here today to serve a Savior, Jesus Christ. And by his love, by his sacrifice, we know that today Dave is in a better place, that his struggles, that his trials are over, and that he is in the joy of the Lord and his Savior, Jesus Christ. I'd like to open this afternoon's service with these words from Matthew. Come unto me, all ye who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we come before you, and we know, Lord, that you are here with us. We know that you love us and that as we sorrow and as we mourn, you are saddened as well. But we also know that there is joy, even in physical death, for those that know your Son. And for that reason, we give God, you, the glory today. We just pray now that you will be with us throughout this service, that you will be with Annette and her family in the days to come. And Lord, we pray that you would help us to be the hands and the feet of Jesus to bring the love to those that are in sorrow. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. David Foster Owen, age 59, of Grundy Center, Iowa, passed away on October 12, 2022. He was born on September 26, 1963, in Rochester, Minnesota, the son of Mike and Pat Owen. David was united in marriage with Annette Blong on June 27, 1987, in Grundy Center, Iowa, at the Sacred Heart Catholic Church. They welcomed their son, John Foster Owen, to their family in 1990. A 1982 graduate of Grundy Center High School, Dave was a member of the FFA, enjoyed playing football, and was honored to be on the homecoming court his senior year. He was an enthusiastic fisherman, hunter, and trapper in his younger years. His spiritual life was rooted in the Reformed Church of Stout, where he freely gave of his time, serving as elder, deacon, and Sunday school teacher. As I read through these things, Dave could have been my brother, because there are so many similarities. Dave was a lifelong farmer, beginning as a young boy helping with the animal chores and summertime field work, running headlong into full-time operations and management. Never one to sit still, he also worked at Pioneer Hybrid in Rhinebeck for 16 years. In 2012, he left that position to take a position at Central Iowa Water, which he held until the present time. David is survived by his wife Annette, son John, daughter-in-law Megan, and granddaughter Addison. And by the way, don't bother with, you know, if she's fussing, that's just fine. Father Mike Owen, sister Linda Wendell, and brother-in-law John, niece Sarah, nephew Mike, his wife Laura, and their son William. Aunts and uncles Jared and Catherine Owen, Paul and Chris Week, Judy and Bob Anderson, and Jan Eric, as well as 10 cousins and numerous close friends. He was preceded in death by his mother, Patsy, in October of 2020, maternal grandparents, Bill and Florence Starr, paternal grandparents, Foster and Grace Owen, and his uncle, Dr. Paul Eric, a brother-in-law, Rick Blong, and his mother-in-law, Bernice Blong. At this time, Dave's sister, Linda, and his son, John, are going to have some family remembrances.
A friend of mine says, you got this, Linda. I hope he's right. First of all, I want to thank from the bottom of my heart all of you for the present and not present who have extended great love, shared words of caring concern, and the tremendous acts of kindness. Some of you have traveled great distances, and I just appreciate that, as does my whole family, so very much. Dave and I grew up in the same loving environment, but that home produced two pretty different people. I kind of liked attention. Dave steered clear of it. He was an athlete, and I was very happy to be on the sidelines cheering. In my spare time, I liked to read, I liked to write, I liked to sing. Dave liked to get sweaty and dirty. And when we became adults, I was like a tumbleweed. He was a tree. So, having said all that, we didn't always get each other. And despite that, there were things I did get about my brother. For instance, he was very correct in his fashion choices. A white work shirt does go with everything. He loved God. He loved his family, and he loved farming. One of the earliest memories I have of my brother is when he was first learning to speak. I think we were getting ready for lunch or something. And he said, Plikordigioler. He must have said that 400 times. Finally, Dad broke the code. It was plant corn when Dave gets older. And Dad said, yes, Dave, you can plant corn when you get older. We also had this 70s fabulous shag carpeting in the living room. And it was absolutely perfect for combining with one of those toy John Deere combines. He ran it back and forth, man, the bushels he combined, I probably couldn't even count. I always admired my brother for the fact that he knew his life's work would be farming. I never had that clearness of vision for myself, but I thought it was pretty cool that he did. It breaks my heart that brother farmer of mine walked into the grove last week and felt that his life's work was done, that he could do no more. My friend Carla, who lost her father in similar fashion years ago, messaged me the morning it happened and said, and I quote, "A healthy mind cannot comprehend the terrors and demons that torture an unhealthy one. I came to understand that he found his release and he was at peace." It is our collective tragedy that Dave and others like him who suffer from the tortures of an unhealthy mind aren't able to see that there's a chance for peace right here in this earthly life among all of us. People who suffer as he did have to be empowered to speak up. I find it amazing that we can say, I have a headache, I have COPD, I have high blood pressure. We can't say, I'm sad, I'm depressed, I'm anxious. People around the people who suffer need to learn to recognize that help is needed, professional help, and then that professional help needs to be much more widely accessible. Everyone, our whole society, has work to do on this. I believe fully, that it can be done if we all pull in that direction. And so I say amen, and again, amen.
I would like to share some funny moments from my dad's life that his close friend Gar and I wrote. Here is the Napa phone story. A few years ago, you needed to back up your contacts on your cell phone. You had to go to the cell phone store to have that done. So Dad and Gar went to Napa, the local phone store. Bill at the phone store did Gar's phone first. He had roughly 125 contacts. Then Dad gave his phone to Bill to download his contacts. Bill hooked up Dad's phone and said, "Dave, you have 3 contacts, and one of them is Gar." The Shack story. Tom Cooper and Gar used to eat at the Shack in Morrison every Friday, but the Shack was always so busy, you had to call and order ahead of time. So one Friday morning at Pioneer, Gar received a call from the office. They said the Shack staff had called to let Gar know that they were closed because the kitchen stove chimney had blown over. So Tom and Gar had to go uptown that Friday. The next Friday, while they're at the Shack eating, they asked them if their stove chimney got fixed. They said their chimney stove was never broken. Dave Owen had called the Pioneer office and made up the story. The chain story. Pat, Gar, and Dad went to downtown Des Moines to move Pat's daughter. Gar and Dad were finishing up unloading the trailer when it looked like what could be a homeless man come up to mention something to Gar about chains. So Gar checked the trailer chains to see what he meant. Gar said he asked about trailer chains. So Dad and Gar were inspecting the chains when Pat asked what we were doing. When we told him, he laughed and laughed and said the guy was asking for change, not chains. 2 country hicks in downtown Des Moines. The Ten Commandments story. So one time a farmer mentioned my dad when he found out he lived in Grundy County that his ground was in God's country. With quick thinking, he replied back saying, "You know, I was out chiseling the ground one evening and realized I hit something. So I got off the tractor and realized a shear bolt was busted. I walked back a couple feet and noticed a rock. I dug and dug to get that rock up and brushed it off and turned it over, and you know what it said? The Ten Commandments." Dad, for you, I am forever grateful for shaping me into the man I have become today. I truly would not be here without your guidance, wisdom, and strength as I have gone through this journey in life. I want you to know you're one of the best at what you did. And may the Lord bless all farmers during this busy season and guide them to seek help when they need it most. Rest in peace, Dad. I love you.
John and Linda, thank you. I've been struggling on what to say. And you two took care of the hard part for me, because I didn't have the words. I didn't know what to say. But from God's point of view, I have a few things to share with all of you this afternoon. From the Old Testament, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall lack nothing. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And then from the Gospel of John, from John chapter 4, I'm just going to kind of give you a little tidbit of what's going on here. Jesus is teaching and preaching, and he begins to baptize people. And the Pharisees did not take kindly to that, because they were showing up John the Baptist. And so he feels this need that he needs to get away a little bit to make some distance for his own safety. And we'll pick it up on verse 4. Now he, Jesus, had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well, and it was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me some water to drink?" The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" And Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and this well is deep. Where can I get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it, as well as his sons and his livestock?" And Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water that I give them will become a spring of water welling up to eternal life." We all know the importance of water, especially in a farming community, and especially after the last couple years. How we longed and waited for those rain clouds to come over the western horizon and to water our soil. We also know the importance of water as we see water shortages for people to drink. Most of you, or some of you, don't know me very well, but I was a farmer. I still am a farmer, and my sons and I have a farm up northwest of Austinville. The one farm has a very shallow well. The water is clear, it is cold, it is good to drink. But the problem therein is that that well is shallow, and if you would pump a lot of water at one time, you could make that well run very slow. It wouldn't go dry, but you could make it run slow. Where my wife and I lived, however, our well was over 375 foot deep. And the water that came out of it, while it was cold and while there was plenty of it, was filled with iron and magnesium and all other things that make a wife cringe when they do the laundry. And so when word came that Central Iowa Water Association was coming into southern Butler County, my father and I were the first to sign up. We didn't care what it cost. We didn't care what was going to happen. We just wanted that water. Not until 3 years ago did I recognize or understand that there was a man in this church working for rural water. Israel's situation in the day of Jesus was much the same. It had an arid climate, it had rocky terrain, and wells were far and few in between, and they were difficult. But there was a well that everyone knew about, a well where the water was clear and where it was good tasting. But it too had a problem. It was very deep. And to get water out of that well took some doing. In today's scripture, we find Jesus, and he's sitting down by a well. He's resting. He's tired. He's worn out. He's concerned about his own well-being and the well-being of his friends, the disciples. And it is about noon. And you have to remember, this well is in Samaria, and he is a Jew. And while he is sitting there, this woman comes up beside him. And Jesus asks a simple question. Could I have a drink of water? I say simple because we've asked for it many times, have we not? Can I have a drink of water? And as Cottonmouth is setting in, I'm going to take a sip. But see, there was a taboo here, because the woman he was talking to was a Samaritan, and as you know, the Samaritans and the Jews fought like cats and dogs. There was another taboo. Men and women did not speak to one another in Jesus' day. It was not allowed. It was just not to be happening. And it was at noonday in broad daylight, nonetheless. But Jesus is carrying on this conversation nonetheless. If you read a little further into the book of John, chapter 4, you will read that this woman was promiscuous. She had a long history behind her. And so here we have this Jesus, the Son of God, talking to a Samaritan, a woman, in broad daylight. And this woman had a reputation as long as you could imagine. But he strikes up this conversation. Can I have a drink of water? And I'm sure immediately that woman thought, well, I don't have anything to send down that well to collect some water. And so she tells Jesus that. But Jesus was not talking about the earthly water. Jesus was striking up a conversation to lead her into something far deeper, that eternal water that he had to offer, that water that could cleanse and refresh, that water that was overflowing, coming up like a spring. And I too have a story about your father, and I didn't know it at the time. But one Sunday morning, we lived about a quarter mile away, and I would do chores on Sunday so my dad didn't have to get up so early. And one Sunday morning, as I came up over the crest of the hill and I looked down towards my parents' place, I could see steam rising from the ditch. It's 20 below zero and there is snow everywhere. Steam in the ditch. I thought, this can't be good. As I got closer, there was a spring of water bubbling up through the snow and the ice, and I knew that we had a real water leak. It's Sunday morning. I try calling the office and I get a recording. But early on Monday morning, they called back and they said, we'll send out a crew. And one of those guys was Dave Owen. Coincidence, maybe? God sent, I believe so. I learned something about Dave that day. Because as the backhoe began to dig a hole beside our well pit where the leak was, it was mud and gunk and gook, and it was a mess. And those of you that have dug, tried to dig in those conditions, you know what happened. You take a bucket full out, you dump it, and a half of a bucket falls back in the hole. But eventually they got close enough that they could see the pipe, they could see the leak, and guess who jumped in the hole? Dave. I didn't know Dave then. I didn't know anything about him. But then God called this farmer to be a preacher here at Stout. and I met Dave for the second time. And Dave didn't recognize me, but I recognized him immediately. And I introduced myself, and he asked where I live, and I said, I live at that place where the water was springing up out of the road ditch in the middle of February, and you came and fixed it. That was Dave. It just was. But Dave was more than just someone who would help you out. Dave was someone who took joy in the people here at Stout. Dave was someone who knew Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior, and he was not ashamed to admit it. And it was a pleasure and an honor for me to serve on the same consistory as he did. Soft-spoken, easygoing, humble. Does that sound like someone else you might know? Jesus Christ, right? Humble, a servant, soft-spoken. You see, Dave received that gift of Jesus Christ, of salvation. But along with that salvation, he also received the gift of the attributes that Jesus had as a human being. And because of that, Dave is at rest and is at peace today. I can promise you, I can assure you that. Because Jesus himself said, if you believe in me, you will have eternal life. Sometimes we as Christians, we like attaching things to the criteria that will save us, right? You have to be baptized, and you better go to church, and you better give some offering because the preacher kind of likes to get paid. Jesus says, believe in me. Believe in me, and you will be saved. As I opened this service, I read those words from Matthew where Jesus says, come unto me, all ye who are weary and troubled and sad and brokenhearted, and I will give you rest. And Dave has found his rest in his Savior, Jesus Christ, today. Doesn't matter about the circumstances of how it happened. He is there. I'm sure Dave would be moved by what is happening here today. If he could see it, he would be moved. But I also believe that Dave would want to ask each and every one of us if we know Jesus Christ like he did, like he does even today. And so since Dave is not here to say the words, I will. Do you know Jesus Christ? Do you know this man who came upon this earth and lived a life that God demanded perfectly? A man that was willing to be a servant, even though one day he will be king. A man who was soft-spoken, a man who loved everyone despite of who they were. Despite of what their life had been, despite of what their life was going to be, he loved them. Do you know this man named Jesus? Because if you do, then the joy of Jesus Christ is in your heart, and it's in the hearts of all of us who believe. And if you don't, Jesus says there are consequences. You will be shunned from me forever, he says. We come broken and weary and troubled. But Jesus reaches out his hands to us today because he knows what we're going through. He too experienced death and sorrow when his friend Lazarus passed away. So I would implore you today that if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that you would do so. It's simple. It's easy. There are no strings attached. All you need to do is believe and ask Him into your heart. And when you do that, you will receive rest. And Dave is at rest now. And I'd like us to listen to the song, "Go Rest High on That Mountain," at this time.
Sun, you work on earth is done.
Rest in peace, my friend. Rest in peace. Let's pray. Father, we have none other to go to except you, because you have made us and you know everything about us. Oh, Lord, sometimes we don't know what's going on in other people's minds and in their hearts and in their lives, but you know. And despite all of that, you still love us. We thank you for that love. We thank you for that love that compelled you to give your Son to come into this world and to die for us as sinners, to take that all on himself, to cleanse us, to make us whole, to give us life-giving water, and at the end of our day, to give us rest. We praise you. We thank you for that. Lord, we do pray again that you would comfort especially Annette and her family in the days to come. Lord, may they cling tightly to your promise and your assurance. May your peace be ever with them. And Lord, for those of us that will go our separate ways, may you be with us. May we be your lights. May we be your vessels. May we share the good news of the gospel with those whenever an opportunity presents itself. And Lord, I pray too, that if there is someone here who has not accepted your Son, Jesus Christ, as Lord and Savior of their life, that your Spirit would move them to do so. And Lord, we know that there would be rejoicing in heaven over that as well. We give ourselves to you, Lord. We thank you. In spite of our sorrow, we thank you for your goodness, your mercy, and your love. And we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. In a moment, I'll ask you to stand and we'll have the benediction. And then the family will exit with the song, How Great Thou Art. So let's stand for this afternoon's closing benediction. And I find this on the back of your bulletin that you received from the funeral home. I'd like the memory of me to be a happy one. I'd like to leave an afterglow of smiles when life is done. I'd like to leave an echo whispering softly down the ways of happy times and laughing times and bright and sunny days. I'd like the tears of those who grieve to dry before the sun of happy memories that I leave behind when life is done. And all God's people said, Amen.
Then sings my soul. Thank you.